Welcome back, Troglodytes, to your daily dose of guitar information, the Trogly's Guitar Show. Do you remember this guitar that we talked about a couple of nights ago? Apparently, it did not leave the factory like this. Which will probably come as a shock to the seller of this one, but there were a few inconsistencies that even I noticed when first looking through this one. Initially, I had thought, okay, this thing was in a display case its entire life, and that's why just the top finish has this different yellowed hue. Because, you know, sometimes that can happen. However, we have photo proof that there have been modifications to this guitar due to somebody who worked at Gibson. Randy Leonard, he actually had a photo of this guitar brand new, and he strongly believes there was only ever one of these things made. And this is what it looked like brand new from the factory. You see all the vines and flowers and everything? That was pure gold on this, and we also had black pickup rings. So that means at some point in time in this guitar's life, somebody added the other colors on this, probably because they thought, eh, that's a little bit too boring. So you can still see the original gold in certain locations, but the blue was added, the green was added, and I'm guessing after they did that, they shot a new clear coat over top of this, and perhaps this is why it's checking in such an unusual way for a Gibson guitar. Now, as far as Gibsons go, whenever they have like a metallic finish, they tend to check, but this one, I'm guessing it just wasn't applied very well, and that's why we had all this rechecking. But what's kind of cool about this is if you hate the finish checking on this guitar, you now have a free pass to go ahead and re-clear coat the front, because it's pretty much been busted here that it did not leave the factory that way. Now, whether it was the original owner that did the customizations, the second owner, or how many owners this thing has had, it's still quite a unique Gibson. So Randy was asking me in his message, how much do you think this would actually affect the value of a one-off piece? And honestly, that's really hard to determine because it's no longer original, but there's only a very few select late 80s high-end art guitars. I would say the effect on value is negligible on this one because it's not like they change too much. I'm sure the right person could get rid of all the additional paint that was put on there, but you'll never get the original top coat lacquer on. But I will say, the pickup rings look way better in white than they ever did in black. But Randy also had a few other guitars to share with us tonight. This right here was a Greg Rich creation, so let's see what else he was capable of. How about this? Look at this freaky guitar. It's got so many cool elements. It's like an ES-styled instrument that I've never seen before, but it kind of reminds me of the Howard Roberts model. Now, there were a few different Howard Roberts models. We're not talking like the custom or the artist or whatever they wanted to call them. We're talking about the Fusion. So if you've never seen this shape before, yeah, you're probably like, that's a kind of a goofy looking guitar. It's got an extended cutaway, a little bit more of a lower body to it than normal. And take a look at the control layout. Diagonal, straight across, the three-way toggle switch there. I would love to check one of these out in the future just because they are so quirky. But take a look at that. They've got a heel cap. This particular one was from 2006. However, the initial Howard Roberts was actually done in the early 80s. So no, this other freaky one did not predate it. Like, here's one from 1980. Its layout isn't quite as strange, but you do have the TP6 tailpiece a little bit back there. You've got these sustain sisters around the bridge. I'll be honest, I don't know a lot about these models, and I've never really been that attracted to them, but I think it'd be fun to check them out now that I've been doing a lot more ES-styled instruments. But yeah, they've got kind of a funky little cutaway going on. So why not give it a Firebird headstock? And then take some elements from the 30s Century of Progress Gibson L-styled instrument. You know, the ones that have the mother of toilet seat fretboards on them. They've just made the entire guitar like that. Headstock, fretboard, and all that. Now, unfortunately, he didn't have a great camera back in the day. It's just amazing that he still has some of these shots. Because a lot of people never knew that these art guitars even existed in the late 80s, let alone where they are yet today. But thankfully, this guitar has actually passed through Grunes Guitars at one point in time, and he did share a few photos of it online. I would have never in a million years guessed that we would have a sparkle blue back on that. I'd be really curious to see how much he sold this thing for. Well, apparently, it was only $9,500. That was a steal for that. I think in the current market, you could honestly find somebody to pay about $30,000 for it, maybe a little bit more. It all depends on the condition and if they enjoy the backstory of this one. This guitar was Fred Newell's, part of the Nashville Now show. If you're not familiar, he was the staff guitarist in the program, and he played many flashy custom-built guitars. And this particular one was done up in 1989. And Groon says it tops them all. I'll let you guys be the judge of that. But as the name of the show implies, this thing is all about the city of Nashville. So the closer up you get to this guitar, the little bit more cheesier it starts to look. But they've got Fred Newell's name on the neck pickup cover. It looks like it's gold. And you've got dog-eared P90 pickups going on here. And then I believe this says Nashville 1989. The rest of it's in gold hardware. It looks like see-through clear knobs. And just a whole bunch of scenes of Nashville on here, including the show's title. So this is all done up in that perloid material. I know the photos aren't the best. It was the best ones I could find. But I love this headstock on that thing with the perloid, the binding, the red bejeweled Gibson logo on this thing. And the fact that it's from 1989 is the biggest thing for me. Because in the early 90s is when all these art guitars really started to blast off. So the fact that you can get one from the late 80s is really special to me. The truss rod cover is kind of interesting on this one though. It's very, very tiny. And it's not the banjo style tuners. It's just regular ones on this Firebird headstock. On the first fret we have Ralph Emery and Shotgun Red. Fred Newell himself. Imagine having a picture of yourself on the fretboard while playing. That's funny, I like that. Minnie Pearl at the 5th fret. Opryland's Riverboat, the General Jackson on the 7th. Even more Gibson embellishment here. Here we've got some music with legitimate rhinestones within the fretboard. The Parthenon replica at Nashville's Centennial Park. And a billy goat on the 17th fret. And you wrap it all up with a farmhouse and a flag. Now, judging by the photo quality, it would not surprise me if he had this guitar many moons ago. So obviously the price would be a lot different if it were to surface today. It would be my best guess this is probably on display somewhere in Nashville. Or somebody who loves that city owns this guitar in their own personal collection. But if there ever was a city that belonged on a Gibson guitar, I think Nashville is a good one. Now, if this is just some random town, yeah, it probably wouldn't hold much value. But this is more so it's an art guitar in a period that didn't produce very many of these. And I love the back thing, a sparkle Pelham blue-like. A Greg Rich creation. So Randy filled me in on a little bit of a story about Mr. Rich. Apparently, he was an absolute nut to work with. He was like the class clown joker. He was always playing practical jokes on people. And apparently, in his artwork, if you look really closely, you can find obscure little things. One that Randy remembered is there's a little stick man taking a leak. I'm not sure where that would be and on what guitar. But it's like how Tom Murphy hides his signature in some guitars. You just gotta look for Greg's craftsmanship. And then to end out tonight's episode, we have one more that he had within his collection. I believe this is Greg himself. Yeah, he looks like a troublemaker to me. But this was a Black Les Paul Custom. Now, this one's not quite as out there, but it gives me serious Gretsch vibes having these style inlays right there. That's like exactly what they do, and they've got the black duo jet type thing going on. But this one looks like some engravings on each of the three pickup covers. Chrome hardware on a Black Les Paul Custom. Unfortunately, the photo kind of cuts out, but it looks like we might actually have some sort of like a tremolo system on this. Definitely not your regular stop bar tailpiece. As well as your regular volume and tone controls and your toggle switch up here. Pretty much what makes this one fancy are the scenes that he put within the fretboard on the big block inlays and the Gibson headstock itself with whatever was put on there. And then you switch it over to the back. I love this. Heel cap and everything. You get another beautiful scene on the back here. But I appreciate the fact that he left the back of the neck black because it matches so well with the rest of the guitar. They've got the black and white headstock with the black top. Then they just kind of reverse it back here. But take a look at this stinger. That is an extra sharp one and it looks pretty good. All right, I guess I lied. We've got one more here I just found. So apparently this was just his thing. He liked doing these perloid stuff. So this is a 335 styled guitar. I'm not sure which one it's actually going after. But this one was representing Las Vegas, and it initially sold for $39,000 in 1989. There's definitely some money to be thrown around. Must be some casino who wanted this. And that was from a list price of $50,000. This one's on Ed Roman's guitar site. I'm not sure if you can still buy it or not, because it doesn't say sold like some of these other ones, but there's not necessarily contact information like the other listings either. But he's wanting $20,000. I think that's pretty fair for something like this, if you're into fancy art guitars. But this has a Las Vegas lady on the back. And apparently he was known for doing banjos as well. Alright, troglodytes, thank you for tuning in today. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and we will catch you tomorrow on the next episode. Take care.